Here's a flashback for you. That's me and Tom Kite nearly 15 years ago. So let's get on to the one that I've been promising to do for 2 months. And the question is, I have Flashback database turned on, and yet I'm having problems to do with archive logs when I'm using Flashback. So let's do a little bit of background first on what Flashback is and why people often get into this problem about missing archive logs, because Flashback doesn't seem to suggest in the documentation that you'll need them. So let's have a look. Flashback database as a facility is awesome, especially if you've got huge databases that are perhaps not in production. And what I mean by not in production is sometimes we want to take data and rewind it back. That's pretty rare in a production environment, because to do so would be to lose customer information, customer transactions. But for things like development or testing databases, where you often want to conduct a test and then rewind that information, conduct another test, try different things, the ability to roll data into a database and effectively bring it backwards in time is a really cool facility to have. And if those databases are large, then the cost of backing that database up and then rewinding it with a full restore is generally prohibitive. The cool thing I like about Flashback technology is it's very, very easy to activate. You simply do alter database Flashback on, and you're effectively off and running. It's, you know, that simple. The question is, what's actually going on behind the scenes to enable that function? Most people will be familiar with the concept in the database of changing data being captured in some way such that it is obviously consistent, performant, and guaranteed to be recovered. So when data changes happen, we have generally two background processes you can see on screen there that look after it. I'll start with the right-hand side one first, which is redo. Redo, as you can imagine, is critical. It's everything when it comes to a database. Every change you make gets captured in redo before that change is actually allowed to occur, because that's really Oracle's only way of guaranteeing that that change can be recovered in the event of some sort of problem. Your redo is obviously a critical part of guaranteeing the data quality and data integrity on your database in terms of its ability to be recovered in the event of a problem. Theoretically, every database could be only its redo. You could simply contain a list of every change that ever occurred since the beginning of time. And if you replayed that forward, you could get your database to any point in time. In theory, you could have no tables in your database, or I should say no data files. You could simply have no data files. Whenever someone runs a query, you start with an empty table, apply all the redo constantly until that table is up to date, and you would have a table as at a point in time. That's obviously performance prohibitive. So what we have is what we call data files and a database writer. From time to time, changed blocks in the buffer cache will be flushed out to disk. In reality, you can think of the database writer really as just a performance enhancement tool. It simply absolves you of the cost of reading through every single change that ever occurred in your redo logs to give you the current state of information in a particular table, in a particular data block, in a particular data file. So the database writer is in its job is to put new blocks down to disk such that we can read those blocks at a point in time more current than at the beginning of time, which is where I redo stuff. So that's just a normal database. How does Flashback database come involved? Well, we introduce a third process. It's called FBDA, the Flashback Data Archiver, I think is the acronym. And because we want to rewind the database or have the capacity to do so, rather than writing new or the changed state of blocks to disk, what the Flashback Data Archiver's job is to do is to capture effectively old images of those blocks, the state before they got changed. Because if I do that, that lets me go backwards in time in the same way that redo and the database writer lets me go forward in time, which is your obviously normal state of operation. So what happens when you do something like Flashback database to 2:05 p.m., we can use that extra information in what we call the flashback logs to take a database backwards in time to undo changes. If you don't know the time at which you want to do a flashback, what you can do is create these things called restore points. And they're really just a tag to which is associated to a particular point in time or system change number in the database, such that when you do flashback to a particular restore point, you're saving yourself the effort of needing to know exactly when you need to go to in terms of a point in time or a system change number. You can just basically choose that restore point. So far, so good. Everything's working fine. But here's what led to this question. Someone tried to do flashback database to, say, 10 a.m. in this case, and they got an error saying the flashback didn't occur because they didn't have archive redo logs. Based on the diagram I had a couple of slides ago where we had the database writer, the redo logs, and almost separately these flashback logs, which seems to be the thing that's required to rewind the database, why would I require redo to actually go backwards? Redo seems to be the thing we need to go forwards. So why do we need redo? Why do we need redo to do a flashback? It's an interesting question. And the reason we do is it's because of the performance overheads we're trying to remove when we're using flashback database. People say to me, I have all the flashback logs. I want to go back to 10 a.m. I've got all the flashback logs at least till 10 a.m. and before. Why can't I do it? Because the cost of flashback is critical to us. When we introduced flashback, we didn't want to say, yes, you can have the flashback database facility, but by the way, everything's going to be 30% slower or 50% slower. That makes it a non-starter in terms of features. What we do is we try and minimize the cost of the overhead of flashback logging. And the way we can actually measure that is by looking at a vDollar view. There's a vDollar view called vDollar flashback database stat. And it says for a particular interval of time, how much flashback data I've captured, and we can compare it to the amount of redo data. Because if you think about every change being captured in redo, you could almost imagine that there should be probably something similar in terms of the amount of stuff you need to capture in flashback. For every change forward, we need in some way to capture a change to go backwards. Now that's risky, obviously, because that would actually double the overhead of logging just by having flashback on. And that's what we're trying to avoid in the database. So how do we keep those costs low? Let's look at how we do it by an example. I'm going to take my typical employee table from the Scott schema. As for those that aren't aware, it's got 14 rows. It sits in one block. It's a tiny, tiny table. I'm going to do 28,000 updates to just any one of those 14 rows. It doesn't really matter, just over and over and over again, 28,000 times, lots and lots of different changes. When I go look at vDollar flashback database stat for the particular time interval in which I did all those 28,000 changes, you can see I chewed up about 9.5 megabytes of redo, lots and lots of little transactional changes. But notice I didn't actually consume that much flashback logs. I actually only consumed 1/3 of that. Now, the reason for that is it's all about how the changes are done to how many blocks. Before I talk more about that, let's now do a different example where I have a table called BigAmp. Now, BigAmp has millions and millions of rows, but I'm doing the exact same amount of work. I'm doing 28,000 updates randomly scattered across these millions of rows, but they're primary key updates. So the actual amount of work being done is identical to the amount of work that I was doing in the previous one on my very small employee table, 28,000 primary key updates. As a result, you can see the redo data is ever so slightly more, probably because the index might be a little bit larger for that table. But notice the flashback data is now large as well. It's about equivalent to the redo data. And the reason we have this discrepancy is what flashback does is all about tracking changes to blocks, not changes to rows. Because I did 28,000 changes to a single block when I was using the employee table, I only really changed one block. I've got 28,000 individual changes there, all of which have to be captured in redo so I can recover the database to any point in time. But with flashback, we're trying to avoid large overheads. So what we do is we say, well, it's only one block. From time to time, I'll capture the state of that block into my flashback logs. Now, if I choose to flashback that database to a particular point in time that's not at the moment I captured that block in the flashback logs, how could I do it? Well, I've got redo stream for that. That's the same reason why my big employee table, with its millions and millions of rows and hence lots and lots of blocks, when I updated lots and lots of different blocks, I had to capture the state of at least that block at least once in order to capture it in flashback logs. And that's why the redo size and the flashback log size was somewhat equivalent. It's not obviously not bound exact one for one, but we can see that the more blocks you change is what impact what goes in your flashback logs. not the amount of rows you change or the amount of changes you make. It's about blocks. Looking at a timeline, let's see how a flashback operation would then work now that we know that blocks are only captured in the flashback logs from time to time, not every single time we make a change. I've done a delete from a table, and as time rolls on, from time to time, I'll grab that yellow box there is designed to indicate a flashback log capture of that block. So I'll dump that to my flashback logs. There'll be more changes from time to time, and as time goes on, I'll grab another copy of that block. There may have been lots of changes between those two times, but I'm only capturing flashback logs of that particular block at regular intervals. And we can see there's a third one and a fourth one as time goes on. Now, if I'm only capturing that certain intervals, what happens when someone says flashback to 9:32 a.m.? What if 9:32 a.m. does not equate to one of those four particular points in time at which I actually grabbed a flashback block? There's 9:32 on the chart. You can see it sits sort of snugly between two of those moments of capture. How would I get flashback information to that particular point in time? Well, what I do is I will flashback to the last flashback block that I actually have before 9:32. So we can assume that one there on the screen is say 9:30 a.m., could be 9:25 a.m., etc. That gets me past where I need to flashback to. So what I really need to now is now come sort of nudge forward a little bit. I need to put some changes back into that block to bring it up to 9:32. But of course, how do I move data forward in a database? I use redo logs. That's just like a database recovery. To shuffle it forward from that last flashback log block forward to 9:32, I apply redo. And that is why to do a flashback operation, to go backwards in time, you need to be able to move forward as well. It sounds counterintuitive, but hopefully that diagram explains. It's like we take a flying leap to a point somewhere in the past, knowing that we can get close to where we need to be and then sort of shuffle forward. It's like taking a big jump and then shuffling forward until we hit the point we need to get to. So for any given point in time, to do that, you need your redo. If you want to have the capacity to flashback to any point in time, from the moment you started flashback logging, any point in time from way back there up until now, obviously you would actually need all of your redo up to the way back to that point. Because if you go back to any nominated point in time, you might need to shuffle forward just a little bit. You need, and because you can nominate any point in time, you have to shuffle forward from any point in time. You need every single piece of redo. Now that is your responsibility. We don't manage that for you, because otherwise we would keep the moment you turned on flashback logging, we would keep the archived redo forever. And that's not something obviously we really is practical. You know, most of us already have backup regimes where we back up archive logs, delete them from time to time to keep space under control, etc. As a rough guide, if you want to flashback to a particular point in time, if you can make the redo available 30 minutes either side, there's a very good chance that you're going to be able to flashback successfully. It's a guide, it's not a guarantee, but generally, because of the frequency at which we capture flashback logs and of particular blocks, 30 minutes either side is going to be a pretty good go. So if you need to flashback database to say last Monday, you can go to your RMAN backups of your archives, restore the archives from either side of say Monday at 6 p.m., say 6:30 to 5:30 p.m., and there's a very good chance your flashback is going to work. If it doesn't, you'll need to get a few more archives. Now, there is an alternative. You can actually have this managed entirely. There's a thing called a guaranteed restore point. And what a guaranteed restore point is slightly different, because what you're telling the database is, I'm not saying I'm going to be able to flashback to any point in time. I'm simply saying this is a list of particular points in time to which I'll be able to flashback. Anything else is generally off the table. It might be possible, but these are the only ones you're going to be able to guarantee. If you choose to use guaranteed restore points and you're using a flash recovery area, and the advantage of that is now the database is more acutely aware of what's going on, what archive logs are available, etc., and you issue your flashback commands from RMAN, not from, say, SQL Plus or SQL CL, etc., then what RMAN can do is, knowing that the combination of guaranteed restore points plus flash recovery area plus issuing it from RMAN, RMAN can manage the process of getting your archives into the flash recovery area if required from backup and then performing the flashback. So we can manage that for you. Needless to say, you still need to have those backups of those archives. RMAN can't invent archives out of nothing. So the lesson here is obviously is be careful. I will reiterate this one thing, and because this always surprised me when I visit customers, is I know a lot of people that they take a backup of their database and they take a backup of their archive logs. And then they'll delete the archive logs from their active area because they know they've got a backup. I can't stress enough how critical archive logs are to everything in an Oracle database in terms of being able to restore it. I'm a huge fan of, I keep as many archives available online as possible until I get, you know, relatively close to my storage thresholds. And then I'll keep as many backups as I can as possible of my archive logs, because if you restore an archive log and it's broken or corrupt, that is the end of your recovery stream. There's no way beyond it. You can't skip a broken archive log. So I stress, just to sidebar off from Flashback Archives, archive logs, so important. Beep, beep.